Hello everyone, Pat Farabee here. This is a webcam direct upload. My camcorder is missing in action somewhere in the heat back there after moving, and my microphone's a little messed up, so I'm going to have to kind of try to keep still, otherwise it's going to rub up against my cheek and make some noise. But this is a video response for Bionic Dance. She asked what it takes to qualify something as a god. She brings up some rather good points, and this is actually something that I talk about during an argument that I have against the existence of God in general, which is that can you really qualify something as a god if there can be something else qualifiable as a god also? So one of the things that she brings up is why aren't things like fairies considered gods if they have magical powers, and that magical powers and being a magical being is really the only major requirement of being a god? Is it the extent of the power? Is it how powerful the being is? Isn't that then just bully worshiping? I mean, don't you just worship, say, Zeus, because if you don't, he'll cast down firebolts from heaven and fry your house. Why is that then a good thing to worship a god like that? Personally, I think that if a being that's called God does not have the qualities that are shown in, say, the Judeo-Christian God, the whole, all-powerful, all-knowing, infinite being, then I don't think it should be able to be considered a god at all, because all it is then is a powerful being. We, in relation to, say, an ant, are as all-powerful as it comes. We can crush an ant at will, we can pick it up and relocate it as if by magic, but we're not a god, we're just a very powerful being in relation to the ant. As such, a Zeus or an Apollo would be a very powerful being in relation to us. Now, the problem with requiring that a being be infinite to be a god is that anything that is infinite then cannot be anything anyway. For example, what is the color of all there is that is in existence? The all-encompassing everything. Many people would say that you can't know the color of the all-encompassing everything, but it's actually very simple to know what color the infinite is, because color does not apply to the infinite. What is color? Color is the frequency of light that is reflected from or emitted from an object. But what would the infinite reflect light into? Anything it would reflect light into must then also become part of the all-encompassing everything. Therefore, there is no color. Color does not apply. It's not black. There just is no color. It does not apply to the all-encompassing everything. Same thing goes for any other property. What mass does the all-encompassing everything have? You'll never know because it's infinite. It goes on forever in all directions, in all dimensions. So you'll never be able to add up all of the mass of all of the things that are contained within. Now the point of this is that if you can't apply something as simple as color or mass to the all-encompassing everything, the infinite, how can you possibly ascribe something as complex as emotion, as intent, as a desire or a command? It's ludicrous. The infinite isn't anything, it simply is. It doesn't actually exist, it simply is. And what I mean by it doesn't exist, it's to exist, you kind of have to have a frame of reference to say that exists, I exist, that exists. It's kind of a definition of something in relation to something else that makes something quote unquote exist. But the all-encompassing everything can't even be said to exist. It simply is. But anything that does exist, anything that is finite in relation to the infinite, is as irrelevant as a speck of dust in relation to everything else. So any being, no matter how big and powerful and impressive, is as a grain of sand in the face of the all-encompassing infinite, everything. And therefore, no more justified to call its morality better than ours. All morality would then be just as subjective, and we would be able to hold that being to our moral standards as much as it could hold us to its. The only difference is the bully factor, the ability of that being to crush us under its oppressive thumb if it so chose, because we don't bow to it. Which personally, I would always oppose such a being. So, again, if there is such a being that is very powerful, can we call it a god? I personally wouldn't call it a god. I would simply say it's a very powerful being. So, if Yahweh did exist and had all of the properties that were ascribed to him as far as personality-wise, I could say two things. One, he is an infinite. And two, I oppose him. Now, there was something else I wanted to talk about. This whole uploading things live thing has got me out of my game here. What was it I wanted to talk about? It was rather important. Oh, the idea of the supernatural. I don't actually believe in the supernatural. I don't think that anything exists anywhere that could be said to be supernatural. I think everything that exists, no matter what it is, has to be natural. And what do I mean by that? I mean that not everything in existence has to be confined by our three-dimensional space-time. We will lose ourselves if we think like that. We'll lose so much of what's could possibly be out there. So let's say ghosts do exist. Are they supernatural? No, they're completely natural in that understanding. Because why? They're confined by their own set of rules, different rules than we understand, but their own set of rules. Same way as if there were wizards out there who could conjure electrical charges and zap people with lightning from their fingertips. Would that be supernatural? No, it would be completely natural. You know, they simply know what magical words to say or what magical thoughts to think or what process is involved in making that happen. You know, sort of like the whole Harry Potter thing. Harry Potter's complete, you know, universe would be natural because, you know, you have to say the right words. Wingardium Leviosa or whatever, you know, to lift something up or whatever the other incantations are. But the point is, because it follows that set of rules, it is natural. So let's say that these powerful godlike beings could actually do all these magical things and zap each other with lightning bolts and fire bolts and such like that. Well, they would still be governed by their own set of rules because think about this for a second. They're always trying to kill each other. So if being magical meant they could do anything they wanted to, couldn't they simply think each other out of existence? Why would they need to have these great battles where they're trying to zap each other left and right? It's because there are limits to what they could do, right? I mean, we're all talking hypothetically here, obviously, but you know, I think that anything that exists, no matter what it is, must exist within the confines of the all-encompassing everything, and therefore must be bound by whatever rules are applied to them within their context in the all-encompassing. So, anyway, I'm going to stop babbling now. I just felt like I wanted to upload a response to this because, again, it's one of those concepts that's kind of special to me. I like to argue this one, but anyway, take care. Have a good day. Bye bye.